Okay, we will continue our topic, antiarrhythmics, the drug used for the treatment of worm infections, or worm, what we can say, helminthes infection. So till now we are able to complete, or we are able to discuss about the introduction of the different types of the helminths. They are the black helminthes and the human helminthes, about the classification of the antihelminthics, and about the benzimidazole. That includes the albendazole, mavendazole, and the thiobendazole. Mechanism of action of the albendazole, their indications, adverse effects, and the dose of the drugs. That these are the things we are able to complete till now in this topic, antihelminthics. So we will continue our topic, antihelminthics. So today, the other drug that comes under the antihelminthics, and I think we know about this drug. We have discussed about this drug in first year also. That is the diethylcarbazine. So diethylcarbazine is the synthetic piperazine derivative. It is the synthetic piperazine derivative. Now, what is the pharmacokinetic of the diethylcarbazine? Pharmacokinetic of diethylcarbazine rapidly absorbed from the GIT. So oral absorption is good. That is the oral absorption of the diethylcarbazine is good. Rapidly absorbed from the GIT, and this drug is widely distributed to tissue except the fat tissue. Metabolism happens in the liver and the excretion in the urine. So what is important, the significant thing is that oral absorption of the diethylcarbazine is the good, very good. That is rapidly absorbed from the GI. Widely distributed to the tissue except the fat, metabolism in the liver and the excretion in the urine. That is the pharmacokinetics. Okay, mechanism of action. I think we know about the mechanism of action. Again, we know about the mechanism of action of the diethylcarbazine. The exact mechanism of action is unclear. But it is assumed that when this diethylcarbazine is given orally, so what will happen after absorption? These drugs alters the microfilarial membrane surface characteristics. That is, it alters the characteristics of the microfilarial surface membrane surface, or the surface membrane. So what will happen? So characteristics of the microfilarial surface membrane is altered, so they are subsequently phagocytosed by the monocytes. What type of the monocytes? The monocytes which are present in the blood circulation. Because we know that this microfilaria, they are present in the tissues. They are present in the subcutaneous tissues. They are present in the skin. They are present in the intestinal tissue. They are also present within the circulation. The cysts are also present within the larvae. Is also present within the circulation. But what happened? These drugs only phagocytose the monocytes. This drug is given, the microfilarial surface membrane is altered, and they are phagocytosed by the monocytes which are present in the tissues, but not the monocytes which are present in the circulation. And besides that, they also enhance the cell-mediated immunity. Of the human host, and increases the resistance to the worm infection. Okay, so I think we don't need to discuss about in this topic in detail, because we have already discussed about this topic in first year about diethylcarbazine. Okay, the exact mechanism is unknown. It is clear, unclear, but it's believed that this drug alters the microfilarial membrane surface characteristics so that they are subsequently phagocytosed by the tissue fixed monocyte. That means the monocytes which are present in the liver sinusoids, but not by the circulating phagocytes. Besides that, they also enhance the cell-mediated immunity of the human host. That increases the resistance to the indication of the diethylcarbazine. Lymphatic filariasis. The drug of choice for the lymphatic filariasis. That means the filariasis is caused by the Wuchereria bancrofti and the Brugia molli. So this one is the drug of choice for the lymphatic filariasis. Loa. Other disease is the Loa, which is the alternative drug. Diethylcarbazine is used as an alternative drug for the treatment of the Loa that is caused by the Oncosarca Loa and the tropical eosinophilia. So what is the tropical eosinophilia? Tropical eosinophilia is the inflammatory response. It is the inflammatory response, or we can say the inflammatory reaction. It is the inflammatory reaction in response to the microfilarial antigen. That may develop the allergic pneumonitis. That may develop the allergic pneumonitis, which is characterized by the difficulty in the breathing, fever, weight loss, anorexia, and the changes in the lungs that can be displayed in the chest X-ray. And the investigation, leukocytosis is present along with the elevated level of the eosinophils, numbers of the eosinophils in the blood sample that is more than 3000 per cubic millimeter, that's the tropical eosinophilia. So the dithiocarbazine is also used for the treatment of the tropical eosinophilia. So drug of choice in the lymphatic filariasis, dithiocarbazine is a drug of choice in the lymphatic filariasis, and it is alternative drug for the disease called the LOA. And it is also the drug that is used for the treatment of the tropical eosinophilia. So tropical eosinophilia is the inflammatory reaction in response to the microfilarial antigens that may develop the allergic pneumonitis. In those patients, if the blood sample is investigated for the counts of the eosinophils, eosinophils count is more than the 3000 per cubic millimeter. Okay, and the other thing is, while giving this drug, dithiocarbazine, they kill the microfilaria. Once they kill the microfilaria, there's a denaturation of the protein. The denaturation of the protein becomes the foreign body for the human being that causes the inflammatory reaction or the allergic reaction. So to prevent that, or we can say the type 1 hypersensitivity reaction. But to prevent that type 1 hypersensitivity reaction because of denaturation of the protein or the dying microfilaria, this drug should be given along with the antihistamines and the glucocorticoids to limit the allergic reaction due to denaturation of the dying microfilaria. I think you know this thing. Okay, adverse drug reaction, again the same, you know about that. So adverse drug reaction due to the dose of the drug, which are less troublesome. So adverse drug reaction after taking the dithiocarbazine, there are two types of adverse drug reaction. One adverse drug reaction that is because of the drug. So they are the less troublesome, like the headache, nausea, vomiting, anorexia, and the drowsiness. And the other adverse drug reactions are that is because of the dying microfilaria, which are the a bit of a problem, and sometimes it may produce the type 1 hypersensitivity reaction that may lead to anaphylactic reaction and the anaphylactic shock that becomes the life-threatening condition also. So due to the allergic reaction, that is because of the release of the protein from the dying microfilaria, that causes the type 1 hypersensitivity reaction, which are characterized by the urticaria, cutaneous swelling, pain, rash, fever, arthralgia, and bronchospasm, and sometimes the life-threatening situation that is called the anaphylactic reaction. This is all about the adverse drug reaction. So because of the drug, they produces the adverse drug reaction, which are less troublesome. They are the headache, nausea, vomiting, anorexia, and the drowsiness. And because of the denaturation of the protein after giving the drug from the dying microfilaria, they may produce the type 1 hypersensitivity reaction. That may ranges from urticaria, cutaneous swelling, pain, rash, fever, arthralgia, and the bronchospasm. And sometimes, in very rare chances, systemic anaphylaxis and the systemic shock. That will become the life-threatening situation. So this is all about the adverse drug reaction of dithiocarbazine. Okay. Now the second other drug is the praziquintol. Okay, can you hear me? Okay, the other drug is the praziquintol. So anti-almitic drugs. So synthetic. So chemical compound. So chemical structure is the synthetic isoquinolone pyrazine derivative. Okay, that is not necessary. Just need to remember only. Synthetic isoquinolone pyrazine derivative. So what is the mechanism of action? So what will happen when this praziquintol is given? So what will happen? This praziquintol enhances the influx of the calcium from the endogenous stores of systole. It enhances the influx of the calcium from the endogenous stores of the systole. So when the calcium is released from the endogenous stores of the systole, what will happen? It increases the tone of the systole. It increases the tone of the muscles or the cells of the systole. So what will happen? That increases the musculature contraction of the systole when the muscle, further followed by the spastic paralysis. So basically there are the two types of the paralysis. One is the spastic paralysis and one is the flaccid paralysis. Flaccid paralysis is because of the relaxation of the muscles. That's called the flaccid paralysis. reduced concentration of the tone that causes the relaxation of the muscles, and to the extreme point it causes the classic paralysis. And the other is the spastic paralysis, that is because of the increased influx of the calcium. So when the increased influx of the calcium to the tone, to the cell will be there. So what will happen? This is the muscle tone. So when the muscle tone is increased to the extreme point, that causes the spastic paralysis. And when the cystoids they become the paralyzed, spastic paralyzed. So what will happen? The worms, the cystoids will be expelled out from the GIT tract, into the feces. That is the mechanism of action of the praziquintal. I will repeat it again. So it's simply synthetic isoquinoline tyrosine derivative. When this praziquintal is given, it enhances the influx of the calcium from the endogenous stores of the cystoid. So that increases that causes the release of the calcium into the cell of the cystoid, that causes that increases the tone of the muscle of the cystoids, which is followed by the spastic paralysis. And once the cystoids become the spastic paralyzed, they are expelled out from the GIT into the feces. This is the mechanism of action of the praziquintal. Okay. Indications. Now, praziquintal drug of cystoids. I have discussed about the cystoids. Cystoids are the flat bodies worm. They are the flat bodies worm. So this drug is used for the treatment of the infection which is caused by the flat body worms. They are the tapeworms. Tapeworms. We know they are the tapeworm. Tinea solium and the Tinea saginata. Tinea solium is the pork tapeworm, and the Tinea saginata is the beef tapeworm, and the Hymenolepis nana. This is also one type of the tapeworm. This is also one type of the tapeworm. This is also H nana. That's called the H nana. That's the Hymenolepis nana. That's called the Hymenolepis nana. So drug of choice in the tapeworm infection. So we called it the tiniasis. Tapeworm infection. In scientific terms, they are called the tiniasis, which is caused by the Tinea solium, Tinea saginata, and the Hymenolepis nana. It is also the drug of choice. Blood fluke infection with the blood fluke and the liver fluke. Infection of the blood fluke is called the cystosomiasis, and the infection of the liver fluke, and the liver fluke is also called the faecula hepatica. That's called the faecalosis. Okay. So important thing is indications. The indication: flat-bodied worms. Tapeworm infection, there are Tinea solium, Tinea saginata, and the Hymenolepis nana, and the drug of choice in the cystosomiasis, which is caused by the blood fluke, and the faecalosis, that's caused by the liver fluke, and the liver fluke is also called the faecula hepatica. Now, the adverse drug reaction. So, this slide is not important, adverse drug reaction. Only the important thing is mechanism of action and the indications. Okay. Adverse drug reaction, mild and the dose dependent. And they are the GIT disturbances. Most of them are the GIT because of the GIT disturbances. Drowsiness, like anorexia, nausea, vomiting, and the abdominal pain because of the GIT disturbances. Sometimes the drowsiness and the headache. They are the mild and the dose dependent. And allergic reaction, as I have already discussed earlier, because of the protein release from the dying worm. That causes the hypersensitivity reaction, allergic reaction. But this drug is safe in the children and the pregnancy. In benzimidazole derivative, we have discussed that the albendazole should not be given for the longer duration. In the pregnancy, like if the infection with the tapeworm, Tinea saginata, and the Tinea solium, the drug should be given for the longer duration, 1 month or maybe sometimes more than the 1 month. But if the pregnancy, concomitantly pregnancy is there, so albendazole should not be given. So this drug can be given alternatively. For the treatment of the tapeworm infection. That is the praziquintal. Okay. So praziquintal is the alternative drug, or we can say the drug of choice for the treatment of the tapeworm infection in case of the pregnancy, because the drug has to be given for the longer duration, sometimes about the 1 month. Now the niclosamide. Other drug is the niclosamide. Mechanism of action is very simple. Inhibition of the anaerobic phosphorylation of the ADP. Within the worms. Inhibition of the anaerobic phosphor addition to the ADP within the worm that leads to the worm death. That leads to the worm death. So there will be no ATP formation. So that leads to the worm, the inhibition of the anaerobic phosphor addition of the ADP leading to the worm infection. Very simple, no? That's very simple. Nothing, no need to explain anything here. So mechanism of action of the niclosamide is the inhibition of the anaerobic phosphorylation of the ADP leading to the worm. Again, indication, same alternative drug in the teniasis and the amnolepsis nana infection. The drug of choice is the, what is the drug of choice? The drug of choice is the praziquintal. The drug of choice for the teniasis is the praziquintal, but this drug is alternative drug for the teniasis and the amnolepsis nana infection. But they are no more used nowadays. They are no more used nowadays because of the better availability of the other drugs like the benzimidazole and the praziquintal. This niclosamide, these drugs are less commonly used, or they no more used nowadays because of the better availability and better property of the efficacy and the better efficacy of the other drug or the better availability of the other drug like the benzimidazole derivative and the praziquintal. But what are the indications? The indication of this drug is teniasis and the amnolepsis nana infection. Okay, adverse drug reaction, no serious type of the adverse drug reaction, only the GIT disturbances, that is the nausea, abdominal discomfort and the abdominal discomfort and the passes of the nausea stool. That's the GIT, only GIT adverse drug reaction, GIT adverse drug reaction. Okay. No serious side effects except the nausea, abdominal discomfort and the passes of the nausea stool. Now the ivermectin. Okay. Mechanism of action of the ivermectin. This drug is also used in some countries like in Bangladesh for the treatment of the COVID-19 also, because this drug have the antiviral property against the RNA virus as well as the DNA virus. So we know that the COVID-19 is the RNA virus, and its mechanism of action depends upon it reduces the viral replication by inhibiting the importing enzyme. That is only the proof, but this drug was used in some cases, and the outcome of the cases were improved, and because of this reason also ivermectin is asked for the broad spectrum antiviral property also other than the anti-helminthic activity. Okay, what's the mechanism of action of the ivermectin as an anti-helminthic activity? They act on the glutamate gated chloride channels at neuromuscular junction of the nematodes. Okay, they act on the glutamate gated chloride channels which are present at the neuromuscular junction of the nematodes. Okay, so what will happen? That enhances the opening of the glutamate gated chloride channels. So influx of the calcium, influx of the chloride. So influx of the chloride inside the influx of the chloride within the cells of the nematodes at neuromuscular junction. So what will happen? They subsequently cause the hyperpolarization of the nematode cells. So when the hyperpolarization of the nematode cells is there, what will happen? That causes the flaccid paralysis of the nematodes, which are then immobilized. So once the flaccid paralysis occurs, what will happen? The nematodes, the worms become immobilized, and they are immediately phagocytes by the reticuloendothelial cells. I will repeat it again. Ivermectin, they act on the glutamate gated chloride channels which are present in the neuromuscular junction of the nerve cells. So what will happen? There's the opening of the chloride channels. Because of the opening of the chloride channel, influx of the chloride inside the cell, nerve cells, influx of the chloride inside the nerve cell of the nematodes will lead to the hyperpolarization of the cells, will lead to the hyperpolarization of the nerve cell of the nematodes, neurons of the nematodes. So that leads to the flaccid paralysis. Hyperpolarization of the cells leads to the further flaccid paralysis, and that causes the flaccid paralysis of the nematodes, which become the immobilized. And once the nematodes become the immobilized, they are phagocytosed by the reticuloendothelial cells. Okay, yes, mechanism of action is act on the glutamate gated chloride channels at the neuromuscular junction of the nematode. Subsequently, it causes the hyperpolarization of nematode cells. That causes the flaccid paralysis of the nematodes, which are then immobilized and the phagocytosed by the reticuloendothelial cells. Okay. Again, indications. What is the indication? Drug of choice in the strangyloidiasis and the onchocerciasis. So strangyloidiasis is also one of these caused by the, this is caused by the strangyloid stercolysis and the onchocerciasis. Okay. and the, okay, only remember the name of the disease. Other thing is not important. Only the name is the drug of choice in the strangile or BSEs and the onco psoriasis. Adverse drug reaction, allergic reaction, rarely. Allergic reaction, rarely. The important thing is that you have to remember the mechanism of action of the ivermectin and their indications. So strangyloidiasis and the onco psoriasis. I think no need to expand anything here. Everything is clear. Now the piperazine mechanism of action is same like ivermectin. Mechanism of action is same like ivermectin. That is the agonistic action. Okay, sorry. That is the glutamate gated chloride channel. Here is the GABA gated chloride channel. This is the GABA gated chloride channel. So agonist action on the GABA mediated chloride channel in nematoid muscles. In nematoid muscles or the cell. Okay, agonist action on the GABA gated chloride channels in nematoid muscles. So that causes the influx of the chloride inside the nematode cells. That leads to the hyperpolarization of the nematode cells, resulting in the flaccid paralysis. And because of the flaccid paralysis, expulsion of the alive paralyzed form from the GIT. Expulsion of the alive paralyzed form from the GIT. I've repeated again. Piperazine agonistic action on the GABA mediated chloride channel. Agonistic action on the GABA gated mediated chloride channel in nematoid cells. Okay, that causes the influx of the chloride inside the cell, resulting in the hyperpolarization of the nematode cell. Because of the hyperpolarization of the nematode cell, resulting in the flaccid paralysis. And once the nematodes become the flaccid paralyzed, they are expelled alive from the GIT tract into the free cells. That is the mechanism of action of the piperazine. Okay. So very simple mechanism of action: agonist action on the GABA gated chloride channel in nematode cells. They're leading to the influx of the chloride. Chloride ions inside the nematode cells is leading to hyperpolarization of the cells that leads to the flaccid paralysis. And once the forms within the flaccid paralysis, they are expelled out from the GID into the tissue. This is the mechanism of action of the piperazine. Indications: alternative drug for the roundworm and the pinworm infection, ascariasis and the enterobiasis. Ascariasis, roundworm causes the roundworm infection is called the ascariasis, and the pinworm infection is called the enterobiasis. And the adverse drug reaction, again, GID, uncommon GID disturbances, that the nausea, vomiting, and the abdominal pain. Okay, in this slide, they are basically going to ask you the question from this slide about the mechanism of action and the indication. They will not ask about the adverse drug reaction. So, at least remember the mechanism of action and the indication. So, alternative drugs, this one is the alternative drugs for the roundworm and the pinworm infection. Okay, others, levamisole and the parenteral pemet. Okay, levamisole is the immunostimulant. Basically, they are the immunostimulant. They have the restricted anti-helminthic property. They are the immunostimulant. They enhances the immune defense mechanism in those patients where the immune defense mechanism is depressed. They enhances the immune defense. We have already discussed about in the first year in the immunostimulants. So levamisole are the immunostimulants. They are the immunostimulants. Which enhances the immune defense mechanism in those patients where the immune defense mechanism is suppressed or the depressed. Okay. So besides that, this drug levamisole is also used as it has got the anti-helminthic property, but only restricted or the limited anti-helminthic property. That's not important. Parenteral pemoid. Alternative drug for the roundworm infection, hookworm infection, and the pinworm infection. They are the alternative drug. The first line drug are the albendazole, and the alternative drug is the parenteral pemoid. Alternative drug for the roundworm, hookworm, and the pinworm infection. Okay. So it's in my update varam lai. So I will take you. Okay, we have finished this anti-helminthic topic.